Hello and welcome to the Elm Goose Driven tutorial, which will teach you visually the Elm language. Not the whole language, but the parts of it, probably. But visual is fun, so it should be fun. We've already created the directory for the tutorial and moved to this directory. Also, you will need to install, to perform these commands, to install the Elm compiler and Elm Live utility, which allows you to develop Elm applications using the fancy technique of hot reloading, which is good. So let's start. Don't wait. To initialize the Elm project, you just need to perform the Elm init command and answer yes on creating the Elm JSON file and the source directory. What we will need, let's start with the application just straight away. It is the You probably don't see a lot, so I will increase the font size here. I suppose 20 or 22 will be enough. No, 20. I like 20. Let's see. Good, good. The start of the every Elm program is defining the application. The type of application you develop, the deciding what type of application you want to develop. And it could be application, like the whole one, the single page application, the document with the title and everything, the element when the Elm application is inserted in one particular HTML element, and the sandbox, which we will use now. I don't like suggestions, really. I like to write everything by myself. Sandbox, because it is illustrative, I suppose. Under these sandbox, you need to specify the init function, the view function, and the update function. Usually we write Elm by specifying types always. It is better to do so, and I will explain why and illustrate that, but not now. Let's leave it simple, and in our cases, mostly the Elm compiler will be able to find the proper types for what we write. Let's have some subject variable. It's not actually the variable, but I will say that a lot of times, like something is not actually something, just don't listen. I have some code prepared, so I know what to write, but I will explain, of course, what I mean by everything. Oh, and of course, we have to import the browser module. What is the problem? Okay, we didn't install. No, we should have. Okay, whatever. The sandbox function asks the developer to define three functions, which is one is initializing the model, another one is viewing the model, and another one is updating the model. Why there is an error? Probably because we haven't haven't compiled the file. So let's do this. I have to make it work just right from the start. So we need to import HTML. And let's try to make it like I'll make source image elm. What is that? Oh, okay, sure. That was the problem. We have a function main, and we define the which way the application is initialized. In case of Elm Life, you just need to usually specify the port. This is the wrong command line. It's not wrong. It's wrong for now, for the current explanation. You don't need all these parameters by default. You just need to write the Elm Life and probably the path to the Elm file, and that's it. But our case is a bit different because we need our custom index.html file. Okay, not now. So let's do it. Let's try it the easy way. It's already in use. Wow. Ah, okay, yeah, sure. Let's come on. I will leave all my struggle in the video. That this one will be the honest video without any removal. As you can see, this is probably our page. Let's write something there just to be sure. And as you probably have seen, it already compiles on the fly. Hello world. Yes. So this is the easiest setup of our application. Let's replace it for now with this thing because I want to describe what it means. This function, it's not the function, it's variable in this case, or the function of zero arguments, is defining the initial state of our model, which is unit for now, which is the type which has only one inhabitant. And we will illustrate that. Really, we will illustrate all the type system. So don't be afraid these parentheses. For now, the view function takes the current model and displays it, but for now we don't care what the model is, and so we write the always function, which is the equivalent to this. Okay, not this one, but this one. To this thing, like we are skipping the argument which is coming into this function. And here we skip two arguments because we don't change the model, and there is also one argument more which contains the message, and these all will be explained. Just please notice that those are lambda functions, so-called, and the only requirement to define them is to put this slash first and this arrow in between. This means that this is the lambda function, and probably you know them from different other languages where you may define the function just on the fly. So for the start, that's it. But we want to use Canvas in our application, and there is the module Elm Canvas, which we will install now, and this will change a bit the way our project works. Now we will switch to this command line here, right? Elm install. Okay. Goose driven tutorial. We'll install this package. Yes, it should work even from the start. Yes, seems so. I have some code prepared as well for this. So to show the canvas, we will need this function, which draws the canvas in HTML of this size. This is the tuple of two elements. We'll also get back to it. This defines the CSS style, and it comes from HTML attributes exposing style. And there is the render function. It expects the render function, which we don't have yet. So we will just replace it with this. Which is the the empty list, sure. And this will be the draw canvas. It will also skip the first argument of the function for now, and later, of course, it will use it. So it's just to make things compile. And we don't see the canvas here somehow. With Elm Live, somehow, sometimes it happens and you have to restart the project to see something in action. There is the canvas, but not the one we're expecting to see yet, because we also need this package asks us to install the npm package on canvas to make it work, because it needs some JavaScript at the site, and so we'll do this. Not the HTTP proxy, but the not the Elm canvas here. Save. Is it for development? Whatever. So that is installed, I suppose. We'll check if it is later. And for now, we have this HTML file, which contains the compiled JavaScript, the compiled Elm file, the compiled main module of our application. And that's what we want to change. We want it to compile to JavaScript file and to use our custom index.html. Let's stop the Elm live. Let's remove the index.html file, move to trash, and create the custom one. Which I also have prepared. Moment, let me copy paste. So what we do here, we take the compiled application. There is none, but it will be in a few minutes. And we also include the Elm canvas.js from the node modules directory. Here it is. And we initialize the Elm application here. And our command to run everything is a little bit different this time. It looks this way. So now we say that we already have the start page for our application. We want the Elm module to be compiled to the app.js, and everything else is the same. So now there should be the proper canvas. Yes, there it is. So this function will stay like this way for a long time. Now we'll render the things, and for that we need to define the type of the render. It accepts another type. I will explain everything. I hope you will understand all the things in the end. And it defines the function which takes the value of this type and creates something that can be rendered on the canvas. It could be text, for example. Let's do the same as we did and display some text. It accepts, as I recall, the position and the word hello world. Yes, it is. So it is that easy to write something on canvas with the Elm canvas package. Okay, it wasn't that easy how you would expect, but still. Let's make the font a little bit larger. Beetle. Previously, I was cutting all these errors, but I don't want to be ashamed of those anymore. it breaks the flow of the tutorial. Sorry for them. I will try to not to make them a lot, but okay, yes. Canvas settings, text, no, text as text, right? Right. So what we do here is we are displaying the text with the given font, and this function, the text function, accepts different settings, which we will use later. But for now, we just use the font setting, which allows us to specify the font and the size of the message of the font. And here is the position of the text and the contents of the text. We'll move it a bit lower so that we'll see the whole sentence. That was hard. All right. Now to the renderers. The renderer, as I said, is the function which accepts some value of some type as the argument and produces something renderable. For now, our subject, the value of the type is unit. If we would want to write the type, it will be unit this way, because it is the same way. Now let's create the renderer. And what I write here is that I want to create something of the type of this type, and this means that this function which I create can render the values of a unit type. Since it is the function, it accepts some argument, but also since it's the value of unit type, we don't care what is inside of that, because it cannot be anything else than this. So we just skip it. And draw something in response. But let's make it, we can write it this way, for example, or since we have the tutorial which is named Goose Driven Tutorial, but we cannot draw images for now. And also there is the problem, because Unicode doesn't have they don't have the emoji for the goose symbol. So we'll have to use the Chinese character for this one. Sure, we haven't replaced it. The call here. Yes. That wasn't actually right, because for unit it's not the goose. Let's define the goose type, which has the only possible value, and it's goose. Do you see that I copy this? I want to copy this a lot, but in functional programming, we don't like to copy a lot. We prefer to create functions for the things we use. So let's do it different way and create the renderer for a string which accepts the string, and for now it's string renderer. String renderer. And we will reuse it here. Okay, not here. That's it. What was my point? Ah, okay, we wanted to create the goose renderer to define it. It will be the same. In this case, we also only the only argument we can get here is the goose. And now we have the compiler error, and it tells us that we're not, because we have the goose render and we try to provide it the this thing, which is not right. Right, well, let's remove it for some time. So we need to pass the goose there. So now this function is the only true goose renderer. This thing I wanted to differentiate. Say we want to define the Highlander type. And the Highlander, there can be the only one Highlander. And if there are two, one should die. And there was one, it was Duncan MacLeod. No, it was Connor before, I suppose. Connor MacLeod. So in this case, our type name is the same as the single possible value for this type. In this case, it is different. And let's create the renderer for the Highlander. Highlander renderer, and it will be the same for now. Now, it is wrong to render the Chinese goose character in response to the unit type, so we will render the string in response. And for Highlander, let's find some proper emoji. So I think I found one. This is this one. But for now, we are rendering the goose there. Let's try the Highlander instead. Highlander render and pass the Connor McLeod there. So this is Connor McLeod, probably already dead. So could be another Highlander somewhere. But it is just the single one possible in this case. So let's do something more interesting and render lists of things and no. So what is next, you ask? I want to replace this unit render with this one emoji, which is facepalm. We'll need it later, I promise. And what we do now, we will render some more complex types. For example, there is the type maybe, which is optional type, and it looks like this. It is defined in the core like this. It accepts some either has nothing inside or has something inside. Just two options. Some name it optional, different ways. The problem, it's not the problem, but the difference we have here is that we have the type parameter again, but as you may have noticed before, it is just as easy as providing the type to substitute as the second argument to the type constructor. So we will need the renderer for the maybe values. Let's copy this one. Why, it's not a lot to write. And now we have another problem. Now it is some minor problem, but already a problem. We have some value, but we don't know what is inside, and so we cannot render it because we don't know how. But what if we take another renderer? Which is capable of rendering the values of this type, the same type as we have here. And so we will use it to render the thing. So as the last argument, we have the maybe value, and let's name it item renderer. The thing that can be complicated now is that it seems that we have two arguments here in the function, but in reality, if we, let's close the list of files, if we just, usually it's in functional languages, it's just replace the thing you defined and it's the same. So this was the renderer and this is also the proper type, but in this case we accept the maybe value because the way it was defined, it was the renderer of the maybe with something inside. And if we replace it, then we replace it with this thing. So let's do it again. But this time, let's leave this thing. I don't know. Yes. So this is the same that previous variable, a type variable A, was replaced by the maybe A. Now you may see that we accept one argument, which is actually also a function, but in this time we won't tell about it anyone. And now we have two arguments for our function and everything seems okay. It was okay, but I tried to explain why. So we have a maybe value. What do? We check what's inside. And if the value is there, if there is nothing, then we show something, I don't know. I have one symbol also ready. One moment, please. Where was it? Yes, here. This is the symbol I like to represent nothing with. And we'll just use the string renderer we used before to render the situation when there is nothing inside. And if there is some value inside, we'll use the item renderer. And since it is the same function which returns the renderable, we may use it to render the value. And now let's test the thing. Maybe renderer. Now it's not enough to provide the value to render, but also the another renderer which is able to render the values inside. And so we have the facepalm emoji, which is, as you probably recall, the renderer for the unit value. Also, if we place the goose here, goose, it won't match because it wants the goose renderer inside, Now it's goose. And if we want Highlander, it is all the same. We'll pass the Connor McLeod. Connor McLeod and the Highlander renderer. Let's split it into strings, into lines. And here is the Connor McLeod. And if there is nothing, any other renderer is able to render this absence of something. And that's it. We can even replace this thing with this lambda function, which keeps the argument and renders what we want. That was the maybe type. We can remove it because we have it in the core library. And another type, which is uncommon, which is common to functional programming, but uncommon for imperative programming, is either. And in this case, in Elm, this type is called result. But we will define our own, and I like this representation more. So either may contain either left value or the right value. Those are just the names. It doesn't mean they lay somewhere. And it's either the value of one type or the value of another type. So you see where it's going. Let's leave maybe there. So that maybe it will help with the intuition. Nothing. So it's still there. So what we'll need to render the either value. In this case, we have two different types to render. So let's name it either renderer. Either renderer. It will render the either values types A, B. And if we would use the same way, we have the renderer for the A type, but we don't have the renderer for the B type. So we will just need to ask a user to provide it. When we define the functions with the types defined, okay, and let's name it a item A renderer and item B renderer, and now it's either value. And we have two options here as well. It's either left value or right value. And we use it use the value from the left. Sorry, it was the in my clipboard the function which is newer. We'll get to that a bit later. So it's just we call the A renderer for the left value and B renderer for the right value. Or if you want, there is no more the case of nothing. And that's it. Let's use it. It's either renderer, the value, let it be left unit. So it's unit render as the first argument. And the second one, what should it be? Because it can be anything. Since we don't use the right value here, let's just keep it the same way as we did before for now. It will be, sorry, we'll skip the argument and render something. So now there is the left value of unit. And what if we want to put the goose here? We will have to replace this renderer with the goose renderer. And because either way types don't match. But what if we want to place the goose here in the right cell? For now, we render this empty thing, but we need to replace it with the same renderer. And again, if we put some left unit value here, the types will not match again. But if we pass the proper renderer for the left value, it will be right. So this is another kind of complex type, and we are able to render it quite easy the same way. And please notice that renderers are, are looking the same way. They just define what type do they render. And also I wanted to create another renderer for the either values. Let's name it either unit renderer, and it will represent the case when we already know that the types here are, for example, the values here are both of the unit type. And in this case, we don't need other two renderers. And we may use the unit renderer for that. But let's do something different. and use this string render. But with different emoji. And we'll do it this way. And this is because in functional languages, sometimes either type represents something that can fail with value of some type, for example, the error, and succeed with the value of another type. Actually, since we don't use the renderers here, it can be anything. It can be a goose here and still unit there. Those will be rendered the same. Let's leave it that way, but also since we don't care about the types inside, since we don't use it, we don't need another renders in this case. It's not unit, it's either unit goose now. Also, we can use the unit render here, just provide the value, and goose render here and just provide the value. That's it for the either type. We can move them, actually they can be defined in any place, so we may define them just before the renderers. Okay, the next one is the tuple, which also has two arguments, type arguments, and let's say it looks this way, but in Elm it looks differently, and it means that it may have two values of different types at one time. In this case, since the type defined it differently, we can have either value of this type or value of this type. But in this case, we have both values, but they are of different types. And let's create the renderer for it. Let's name it tuple renderer. Same way, we don't, may do not care about the types if we use some predefined renderers. We could have also passed, by the way, the value here. Since they match with the types. It's not either value anymore. And we can take the values this way, a value, b value. It is called pattern matching, and we may deconstruct the values of the types this way. And since now we have both values, we finally have a problem, because another problem. Problems are cool, actually, because they probably make us think. What is the problem? Is that we can return only one renderable from a function the way we defined it, but now we want to show two values of different types. So we will have to redefine the render a bit, but in any case, we were supposed to need it. And so we redefined the renderer, and everything breaks. Should break. Why didn't? Okay. It will. It breaks in the positions one by one. So now we may return the list here. Oh, it should be for now. Unit render a value and goose render b value. Now, since they both return lists, we'll have to concat. Yeah, now it breaks. But don't be afraid. It's actually easy to fix the things. Now we return the list of things. So we did this, since here is actually the list, but this way it is shorter to write this call without the parentheses. And in this case we'll need to concatenate the lists. It means append this list to this list, and I usually format it that way, which is probably not the proper one, but I do. And now every our renderer has to return the list. Why everything works? Because we reused other renderers here, and since this string renderer returns the list, all these renderers work. This renderer works, now it returns the list, and so on. It wasn't that scary, as you may see. And the tuple values. Let's show the tuple value. So we use the tuple renderer. Oh, for now we don't use any renderer, and it should be, yes, it should be the tuple which contains the unit type or the goose. And now we render both. As you may see, like, it is the face palm on the background and the goose on the foreground. Right? Right. And let's make it the renderer which supports different values of different types, the same as here. It's copy that. So now we have A renderer and B renderer, and we use A renderer for the A value and B renderer for the B value, and this is the same. And if we change, for example, these to the unit type, we get the error and render both, they are the same. And for example, if it is a string foo, for example, we will need string renderer here, and it will be the string. So that's it for now. And in the next section, we will create the renderers for even more complex types, and also lists and the grids and the spirals, I suppose. And then we will be able to render images and maybe some animation even. So that's it for now for the first part. I hope you liked it. And I hope it wasn't that boring. Bye.